And I'm really excited to today introduce Professor Paula Arai. She's professor in Buddhist Studies at Louisiana State University. And probably all of you know I work on Soto Zen, and I have read her research since many, many years, since I'm a PhD student. And I was very much influenced by her work on Japanese Buddhist women, which was groundbreaking. She was one of the first who started working on Japanese sotonans in contemporary Japan, even during her PhD work at Harvard, and then she studied in Nagoya in the nunnery there under Aoyama Roshi, who's a very famous Japanese Soto Zen teacher and nun there, and very influential. And her first book really showcases the nunnery training in the nunnery. It's titled Women Living Zen, Japanese Soto Zen Buddhist Nuns. And it was really groundbreaking work in that it showed how Japanese Buddhist nuns put or uphold traditional Buddhist practices within a very male-dominated institution in Japan. And it's very stark contrast sometimes compared to the monks, and they are very proud of their practice, and it came out in the book very nicely how much effort and dedication they put into these traditional practices. And then her next book, which was also very exciting, I have it here, Bringing Zen Home, that turned to the lay side of Buddhist women in Japan. So her first book was on the nuns, and this is now on lay women. And it showed how Buddhist women engaged with nuns and also in Buddhist ritual practices as a healing practice. So it was really new to look also at healing and religions at that time. And it gives a really good insight in ethnographic study of contemporary Soto Zen Buddhism. And her latest book, which is a gorgeous book and I can really recommend, Painting Enlightenment. It's a wonderful book about also about healing practices, but related more to artworks and how Iwasaki Tsuneo used artworks as a practice in terms of expressing enlightenment in his artwork. Mm-hmm. And it's a wonderful illustrated book, and I can recommend it to everyone to read. It's a great book.
And he was a biologist. This was done in retirement. Yeah.
And so beautiful paintings, and Professor Arai also analyzed them very nicely and put those together. I think it's a really good book combining artistry and Buddhist studies scholarship. Yeah, so without further ado, I would welcome you, Professor Paula Arai, to the talk. And I'm very excited today to learn more about Japanese Buddhist women and healing practices.
Oh, well, thank you all. I guess I will be courageous, since you are all so thoughtful. We're all safe. I'm vaccinated. So I'm happy to be here and literally see your faces live. It's quite a thrill. And so what I'm going to offer today is, in a sense, a collage that puts the first two books together. And with my more courageous articulation of how I frame it than I was willing to do back when they were written. Buddhist women made generative and perennial contributions to Japanese history. Full stop. They were central agents in cultivating the foundation of Buddhism in Japan in the sixth century. They were active participants during the formative years of the Soto Zen sect in the 13th century. Monastic women induced major advancements in the 20th century. They displayed a creative vision that navigated them through sometimes muddy water, a testimony to their seriousness of intention, commitment, and creativity. My presentation highlights Soto Zen female monastics' interpretation of central teachings of the recognized founder of Soto Zen, Dogen, dates 1200 to 1253, and their efforts to bring the institution in closer accord with that understanding. I will discuss the healing practices of lay women who draw on Dogen's teachings, though few tarry over sectarian concerns. Soto nuns today maintain that Dogen was part of the social climate of inclusivism characteristic of the Buddhist reformers of the Kamakura period, 1186 to 1333. The nuns point to texts that they claim support their view that Dogen took an affirmative stance toward women. This grounded their sense of legitimacy and fueled their fight to reform Soto sect regulations to reflect what they thought was the intent of Dogen's thoughts and writings. In an interview with Abbess Aoyama Shundo, who, as Michaela mentioned, is one of the most highly respected monastics in Japan today, regardless of sect or gender, I learned that she begins her analysis of Dogen's attitude toward women with her understanding of his experience with his mother. Aoyama surmises that Dogen deeply felt his mother's pain at having been married off in a political struggle to raise the waning strength and status of her family, the Fujiwaras. Dogen resolved to understand the true meaning of impermanence upon watching the smoke rise from the incense at his mother's funeral. Although this might be a hagiographic account, one can imagine the emotions of a 7-year-old boy who just lost his mother only a few years after losing his father. Her untimely death made more acute Dogen's sensitivity to the ways in which women were sometimes mistreated in Japanese society. Aoyama suggests that this respect for his mother contributed to his positive stance toward women. Whether or not her analysis can be verified historically, it is worth serious consideration as a way a leading woman today within Dogen's own tradition articulates his attitudes toward women. Soto nuns have noted the texts in which Dogen mentions women. In his 1231 text Bendowa, Discourses on the Practice of the Way, Dogen unambiguously articulates that male and female practitioners are equal. He wrote this text after he returned from China, determined to teach true Buddhism. During this period, he had at least one female disciple under his tutelage and lay people around him. During the following decade, he wrote a number of texts that are considered the core of his philosophical writings. The philosophical orientation that unfolds in these texts supports the statement that males and females are equal in practice. In 1233, after moving to Koshoji, Dogen wrote a text that had been proclaimed as his most fundamental philosophical treatise, the Genjo Koan, actualizing the fundamental point. In the spring of 1240, just 3 years before he left for Echizen, where he established his monastery now called Eiheiji, Dogen wrote the impassioned text Daihai Tokuzui, prostrating to the marrow of attainment, in order to extinguish the errors of those he thought harbored incorrect thoughts about women and Buddhist truth. In the following Daihai Tokuzui passage, he clarifies the confusion surrounding female Buddhist teachers. Quote, "It is irrelevant whether a guide has male or female characteristics and the like. What counts is that the guide be a being of virtue, of thusness." End quote. He continues with advice on the appropriate way to express respect and gratitude to a teacher of the Dharma, regardless of their form. Quote, "Valuing the Dharma means that whether your guide is a pillar, a lantern, a Buddha, a fox, a demon, a man, a woman, if it upholds the great Dharma and attains the marrow, then you should offer your body-mind as its seat and serve for immeasurable kalpas." End quote. His point is that women can be competent teachers, even qualified to teach men. Dogen includes an even more direct criticism of the practices he finds in Japan in a version of the Daihai Tokuzui found in the 28th fascicle of the Himitsu Shobogenzo, the secret Shobogenzo. It is a poignant example of his frustration with the inadequacy of Japanese Buddhist practices. Quote, "There is a ridiculous custom in Japan. It is the practice that nuns and women are not allowed to enter the places called restricted territories or training halls of the Mahayana. Such a perverted custom has been practiced for ages without anyone realizing its wrongness in the least. Those practicing the ancient way do not reform it, and those who are learned and astute do not care about it. While some say that it is the work of the incarnated Buddhas and Bodhisattvas, others claim that it is a legacy from ancient worthies. Yet, all fail to reason about it. Their egregious absurdity is truly hard to believe. I guess some of us must feel that about our times too. If some such obsolete practices do not have to be redressed, does it mean that the cycles of birth and death need not be forsaken either?" End quote. In the Daihai Tokuzui, he takes the story of the Naga princess in the Lotus Sutra becoming a Buddha and equates it with a 7-year-old girl being teacher to a 100-year-old monk. This suggests that he interpreted the Naga princess story in a light that was favorable to females. Seeing the Daihai Tokuzui, in which he unambiguously and insistently expresses positive views of women, in the context of his most important philosophical texts, suggests that Dogen wrote the Daihai Tokuzui with clear awareness that his emerging philosophy fully supported understanding males and females on equal terms. Nonetheless, the prevailing interpretation among several academics is that Dogen held egalitarian ideals in his early years, but he did not take them with him when he established his serious monastery in Echizen. This view of Dogen suggests that he was an inconsistent philosopher with little integrity. In the face of the sheer number of passages in Dogen's texts that develop his positive view of women, versus one sentence to the contrary that appears in a text revised after Dogen's death, the case for Dogen reversing his views on women is not well supported. To offer the compromise that Dogen did not change his stance philosophically, but he just decided it was impractical to have women practicing at Eheiji, does not resolve the issue. The historical record does not support such an interpretation. A number of monastic women were under his tutelage through to the end of his life. Moreover, Dogen's male disciples continued to take female disciples for generations past the founder's death, a practice that continues to this day. Shifting focus to contemporary or more recent women living monastic Zen. When Japanese Soto Zen women look at history through a lens empowered by non-dual wisdom, they see women seriously engaged with Buddhist practice. Despite the historical circumstances that included structural oppression of women, they did not just simply listen to men who did not understand their worth. Just as men did not need women to affirm their existential value, women did not need men to affirm theirs. In a cosmology and ontology of interdependence and emptiness, there are no grounds for demeaning and divisive thoughts. From this vantage point, there is no distance to span to reach the ultimate goal of actualizing Buddha nature in each moment. though many institutional regulations did not reflect these metaphysics, no regulations could prevent the women from realizing their ultimate goals. At the dawn of the 20th century, fortified by the conviction that their founder, Dogen, had teachings that affirmed women's practice, Japanese women were deeply committed to living a Buddhist monastic life. Although academics have become divided over the significance of Dogen's egalitarian teachings, practicing Zen nuns were not and are not divided. Nuns embrace Dogen's view of women as positive. Empowered by Dogen's writings, the nuns have affected the course of Soto history in the 20th century. But they began the century encumbered by misogynist regulations in a sect administration that did not acknowledge nuns' abilities, contributions, or commitments. Nuns did not have training facilities supported or authorized by the sect administration, nor were they permitted to enter the Soto sect university, Komazawa. Compounding the limited resources available to them, the requirements for a nun were considerably lengthier than those for their male counterparts, sometimes necessitating 1, 2, or 3 years more in training. This extra effort was only formally rewarded with degrees lower than the lowest male degrees. A significant core of Soto nuns were determined to rectify these inequities. Starting in the 1880s, they began to reach their goal by combining monastic discipline and training with secular education. They organized themselves in a concerted effort to compel male sect leaders to what they were told were Dogen's teachings, on egalitarianism. Undaunted by a male-dominated institutional hierarchy, they demanded the sect regulations treat male and female monastics equally. They did not wait for the sect institution to support or recognize their efforts. They took action in accordance with their interpretation of Buddhist teachings. The women chose to lead strictly disciplined and refined monastic lives, rather than continue in successful careers and the comparatively unconstrained and unregulated quality of secular lives. The first monastery school was resident Soto nuns was established by a nun in Gifu Prefecture on 1 April 1881. Nuns had not yet received recognition from the sect administration for their efforts. But shortly thereafter, each region established its own school for nuns. In 1887, the second school was established in Aichi Prefecture, followed by one in Kyoto in 1888, then Tokyo in 1889, and Toyama in 1892. These monastery schools gave the novice women training in Buddhist practice and a general education. Mizuno Jōrin, Hori Mitsujō, Ando Dōkai, and Yamaguchi Kōkan, collectively their dates span 1848 through 1933, are the four pioneering nuns who founded Aichiken Sotoshu Nisō Gakurin on the 8th of May, 1903. They were each well-educated. In 1902, they decided it was time to advance the education of all nuns and receive recognition from the sect. Mizuno led the effort. Quote, "For many years, I have been responsible for cultivating nuns. I have encouraged them to practice the way while walking, stopping, residing, sitting, and lying down. The current group of nuns has come to be dissatisfied with the education at Yōrin An," the monastery's school name established in 1887. "We are therefore resolved to establish a monastic school for nuns," they called Nigakurin, "with official recognition from the sect. It will support the future education of monastic women. We cannot quit. Together, we vow to establish the nun school through a spirit of cooperation." End quote. Their beginning was modest. They used Ando's small resident temple, Yakushido, now called Kōrinji, as their shelter and schoolroom. 22 women entered in the first year. There were 8 teachers. All 30 meditated, studied, ate, and slept in the 2 6-mat tatami rooms, approximately 220 square feet, less than the size of this room. Their studies included Dogen's teachings, Soto and other sect teachings, Zen practice, rituals, classical Chinese, history, science, math, calligraphy, sewing, tea ceremony, flower arranging, and language, of course, Japanese language. On their 20th anniversary, they began publishing the nunnery's journal, Jōrin. Mizuno wrote the following for the celebrations, quote, "Although many people thought it was quite a risky enterprise for those with no economic support or knowledge about the ways of the world to organize such an institution, with unwavering peace of mind, we endured hardships of body and mind and have surmounted the difficulties from start to finish with steadfast sincerity from the bottom of our hearts. This is the requirement of being single-minded, not divided in two." End quote. The four founders left a legacy of competent nuns in their wake, so their passing did not interrupt the steady flow of progress. By the nunnery's 30th anniversary in 1933, the school had added Buddhist history, religious philosophy, pedagogy, logic, and psychology to their curriculum. Through the war, 140 novice nuns, like all able-bodied people, were mobilized for labor by the government. They had to carry gas masks on their shoulders in case of an air raid with poison gas. On 14 May 1945, a time when hunger was incessant, an air raid left the nunnery in ashes. After the war, they resumed their diligence in fortifying their educational and practice offerings. And in April of 1970, they successfully established a Tokubetsu Nisodo. The designation signals that they could train high-ranking teachers equal to the highest male monastics. The strategy of the early leaders to concentrate on education bore the desired results. They set out to train young nuns to think carefully about what needed to be done. And they produced hundreds of nuns who knew how to dismantle the male power structures that sought to institutionalize the nuns' subordinate status. These nuns of the early and mid-20th century had become strong under the hardships of war and the frustrations of unequal sect regulations. They were poised for action. Having firmly established the educational foundation, the nuns directed their efforts to rectifying the other inequities of the sect administration's regulations. Nuns went from ranks below that of all monks to being permitted to attain the highest levels of their male counterparts. The fight for equality in monastic ranks, teaching ranks, and temple ranks was carried out through the Sotoshu Nisodan, the Soto sect nuns organization, an official organization established by the nuns in 1944 for addressing the needs of Soto nuns. Notice how close that is to the war, and they're doing this. Their battle with sect administration was led by the invincible efforts of Kojima Kendo, her dates 1898 to 1995. One of the most prominent nuns of the 20th century, she lived by the Zen dictum of resilience. 7 times down, 8 times up. Her life is a series of first-time opportunities claimed by and granted to a Soto Zen nun. It is no coincidence that Kojima's most zealous and productive years coincide with the period of most rapid progress toward equality for nuns and the sect institutionalizing regulations more in accord with its founder's teachings on non-duality. Kojima said that being a nun required a commitment of steel, which she forged in the unbearable heat of blatant discrimination of female monastics. At age 12, she ordained and she quickly noted the discrimination between monks and nuns. Kojima said she could not endure it. She took her formal education beyond what any nun had done before, matriculating at the Soto sect's Komazawa University in 1925. In December 1945, Kojima joined a nun's retreat, or sesshin, at Eiheiji. During the retreat, they studied the Daihai Tokuzui fascicle of Dogen's Shobo Genzo, the text renowned for Dogen's most explicit articulation on the equality of men and women. With Kojima at the helm of the Nisodan, the reforms continued to dissolve the bastion of male authority and power over nuns. On 29 September 1952, Kojima's efforts were acknowledged with an award of excellence at the occasion of the 700th memorial of Dogen. In 1980, when Eiheiji celebrated the 700th memorial of Dogen's successor, Kōun Ejō, Kojima led the ceremony as Shōkoshi, honored head celebrant. Having literally pounded her fists on tables in meetings with only men, she was the fitting choice to be the first woman to lead at a ceremony at the temple Dogen founded, complete with high-ranking yellow robes. She remarked, quote, "I never thought nuns would hold a ceremony at Eiheiji. We nuns accomplished our goals rather quickly, a true testament to the heart and spirit we put into our actions." End quote. Kojima's life history is a concrete illustration of the tension between the self-perception of monastic women as equals in the Dharma and their struggle with the institutional authorities. Her story, however, is not merely a story about battling the oppressive male-dominated institution. It is a story of creative triumph. Summing up the key to her invincible spirit, she says, quote, "It is important to realize this strength from the outside, but even more important is the inner strength," end quote. Kojima blazed a trail to eradicate all rules that gave preferential treatment to male monastics and brought the sect into accord with its founder's teachings. Wielding non-dual wisdom, a force dualistic thoughts and discriminatory rules could not thwart, Kojima prevailed. Turning to women living domestic Zen, lay women, too, are practiced in navigating muddy waters. Dogen's teaching that practice is enlightenment undergirds their domestic Zen, unlike its monastic counterpart, which thrives on control, discipline, and impeccable cleanliness. Domestic Zen is at home with the chaotic, emotional, and messy lives of people struggling with their families, health, and jobs. Women are the hub of domestic Zen modes of tending to daily tasks, crises, and healing. Their influence is imparted through embodying the teachings in daily life, imbuing households with Dharma in action. As in monastic practice, cooking and cleaning are rich opportunities to practice. The rhythms of family life, however, are often unpredictable. They require acute awareness to respond to the vicissitudes of emotions and health needs of a family, which can be painful, demanding, and messy. Giving birth, raising children, caring for the sick, and ushering transitions into death are hallmarks of domestic Zen. Women are often the creative generators of healing practices that weave wisdom into the fabric of a home. Healing in this context is a way of acting, seeing, thinking, and holding your heart. It is an art to seek out ways to be grateful in the face of fear-driven and torment-ridden possibilities. This way of living and interpreting the world, self, others, and events involves orienting themselves to act in harmony with the way things are, impermanent and interrelated. Their way of healing targets 10 activities: experiencing interrelatedness, living body-mind, orchestrating rituals, nurturing self, enjoying life, creating beauty, expressing gratitude, accepting reality as it is, expanding perspective, and embodying compassion. Home altars are central to domestic Buddhist practices. The altar is the physical focus for revering deceased loved ones. Soto Zen funerals recognize the deceased as enlightened. In so doing, the teaching of interrelatedness gets stretched across the illusory boundaries of life and death, facilitating intimate interactions between loved ones. The altar is a safe harbor where a person can receive support from a wise and compassionate Buddha, a personal Buddha, who understands you and cares for you in particular. Whether facing heart-wrenching and intractable situations or engendering awareness that one is loved, such relationships provide quiet, private, and profound healing. Connections are fostered through daily offerings of food, flowers, and incense, chanting scriptures and conversation, which enlarges the woman's perspective on their experience, especially in the midst of daily chores and tight schedules. Through ethnographic research, I discovered how one woman, I'll call her Honda-san, wove a simple healing practice into her daily life. No one taught her how to do it. Each time she comes back to her studio apartment, I notice she calls out, "Tadaima, I'm home." She is engaging in a common Japanese family greeting reserved for those coming in and out of their home. Honda-san, however, lives alone. She is addressing the photos of her parents on her homemade bureau top Buddhist altar. They passed away more than 3 decades earlier, yet they are still her family. Her heart hears their response, "Okaeri nasai," welcome home. Honda-san transformed an ubiquitous household greeting ritual into a healing ritual. With each greeting into the empty apartment, she feels loved. She knows she is not alone. Another woman created a healing ritual for herself regarding a deeply painful situation that became a wellspring for ongoing gratitude, as she had done for more than 3 decades. After finishing the breakfast dishes, Nogawa-san went to the talisman adorned and ornately carved Buddhist altar that had been in her husband's family for generations to perform her morning ritual of offerings and chanting. She placed a cup of tea in a mug on the altar for her personal Buddhas, then lit the candle and a stick of incense. The small room had begun to fill with the aroma of incense when she glanced at the small clock placed between the incense burner and the bell, only in Japan. Noting the time, she called out to her husband, "Take out the trash, because they're going to collect it any minute." She then struck the bell, put her hands together in prayer, bowing as she chanted the Heart Sutra from memory. Today, she would chant the whole Kannon Sutra because it was the 20th anniversary of her having decided to adopt her sister's child as her own, since her sister's family had already had several children. Today is a private anniversary, a chance for Nogawa-san once again to give thanks to her personal Buddhas for assisting her in becoming a mother. Women in domestic Zen also engage in contemplative artistic practices as a mainstay of their healing activity repertoire, including calligraphy, scripture copying, and poetry writing. Brushed calligraphy is an art that visibly mirrors the heart mind of the brush holder. Each hair of the brush is a delicate instrument that attunes to the subtlest reverberations of emotion and the slightest turn of thought. If the woman holding the brush is sad and tired or impatient with her pain, it is all laid bare on the page. If the brush is moved by deep gratitude for having one more day to live, or softened by compassion, the flow of the brush reveals a deeper quality of movement. The brush only records what occurs in the present moment. At each moment in this aesthetic practice, the woman receives immediate feedback on the condition of her heart mind. Hence, she can make decisions and adjustments along the way. The Heart Sutra, a popular and prized Buddhist scripture, is the perfect length of scripture to brush. It's one page long enough to help the calligrapher settle into a stable peace. Brushed calligraphic copying of scripture is a contemplative practice that numerous women do as part of their healing mode of living. It is done both in temple settings and at home. A woman with chronic pain makes a tremendous effort to not miss scripture copying held at the Aichi Senmon Nisodo Nunnery on every third Saturday of the month. It's still happening, you can go. She attributes the aesthetic practices of scripture copying to helping her grow in a range of ways. It has helped her not indulge in self-deprecating thoughts and to assume responsibility for what happens. It has also inspired a profound sense of gratitude in an effort to understand how this practice is healing for her. I wondered if she prayed for pain to end in the space for prayers at the end of the scripture copying sheet. I was stunned to learn it never occurred to her to pray for that. Rather, the practice helps her heal by offering the calm space to gain a deep and broad perspective. Listen to how her response applies rather than explicates the meaning of the scripture she copies. Quote, "Thinking your problems are caused by other people, or that they are other people's responsibility, it's more difficult and painful to think of yourself as a sacrificer or a victim. If you feel gratitude, you begin to see many things. I really think gratitude is a miraculous medicine. And then your heart becomes light and other things begin to feel better too. I sometimes think that my legs becoming bad is a good thing. I've become able to feel all kinds of different things. It is very interesting to see things from the perspective of having bad legs. And she likens the pain to worse than a dental drill accidentally hitting your gum. She said, that will move away. This pain won't. So we're talking intense chronic pain. She is not alone in finding the aesthetic practice of scripture copying heals. Others also expressed how engaging in this ritualized activity of body-mind helps them focus on the present moment where they can gain stability and clarity. It draws open their hearts to accept even undesirable things as it exposes their heart-mind to themselves. Poetry writing is also a favored healing activity. An elder woman who had lived a busy life, a full-time job, raising children, and caring for her own home, was surprised by the emotions that surfaced when she moved into an in-law suite made for her in her eldest son's home. Composing a poem helped her face her situation. Loneliness is not in the mountains. It is not in the city when a person is by herself. It is when a person is among many people. She said it was the sounds from the other side of the wall, everyone actively busy with their own business, that made her feel like an outsider in her own home. Putting it into verse helped her understand the human condition and release some pain, recognizing that others too felt this kind of loneliness helped her not feel so alone. Although flower arranging is done as a common healing activity, one woman shared how just viewing flowers taught her a life lesson that helped her heal from the cracks opened in her heart over the loss of her mother. Quote, when I was riding my bike through the falling snow on a cold day in February, I saw the bud of a plum blossom. I thought of all the energy the bud was exerting to bloom even in the winter. It is not just the energy of the bud, it is the energy of the universe working to bloom this flower. The world is working so hard to activate this flower, and it is working for me too. At that instant, I felt embraced by that energy. The Kannon Sutra says that there is this power that holds you. This is it, Kannon Riki, compassion power. There is a huge power in the universe that aims to make flowers blossom. End quote. Whether they composed poetry or just viewed flowers, these women of Zen know that beauty is an activity of the heart. They understand that beauty making is a choice to perceive something in its wholeness, where its deepest beauty is illuminated. Once they are aware of beauty in their midst, it works as an antidote to bitterness and stops calcifications in the heart. Acting as a solvent that loosens debris in the heart, beauty melts self-pity and dissolves divisions. Beauty signals it is safe to open up, enticing all six senses, including mind consciousness, to perceive connections. Empowered by this awareness, the women recognized themselves as an integral part of a vast, interconnected web. They learned how perceiving something as beautiful is an act of not resisting the flow of causes and conditions. To perceive beauty is a profoundly refined mode of acceptance. Through engaging daily activities with concentrated focus and embodied awareness of meaning, they induce the body-mind to be in a beauty-making mode. Harmonizing diverse elements into an integrated whole is the highest and strongest mode of beauty-making activity. These women have learned that making beauty is nourishing, revitalizing in the midst of tragedy, and inspires creative ways to integrate loss into life. One woman succinctly sums it up: I know I am healed when I am kind. Based on ethnographic research and interviews with women like Honda-san and Nogawa-san, I found that Japanese Zen Buddhist women are a deep and largely hidden reservoir of resources for healing that draws on the wisdom of Buddhist traditions. They represent a dynamic current in contemporary Buddhism that has largely gone unnoticed, not just by scholars, but by Japanese society in general. In many cases, even their daughters will not listen. For these women, healing is not a state to obtain. Rather, healing is a posture towards life. It is an orientation that leans in to experience reality as a nourishing womb of interdependently related events. The flux of causes and conditions are boundless. Bowing to such vastness is not an act of acquiescing to a subordinate status, but an expression of humility in the face of vastness. Being open to the current of the cosmos and not impeding its flow is a posture of trusting and not being afraid. It does not mean hiding from, ignoring, or denying the challenges and vicissitudes that occur. Rather, facing complex emotions and undesired developments helps one integrate them, precisely so they do not become hidden emotional landmines or mental barriers depriving one of a larger sphere of dynamic compassion. Without rigid resistance, a buoyant joy arises and radiates gratitude. Zen laywomen approach healing as an art of seeing everything interrelated in a dance of change. Their aesthetic practices facilitate a direct experience of interrelatedness that activates gratitude, peace, and intimate connections. They experience connections to family and friends, living and dead, and perceive expansive connections to nature and the cosmos. The wisdom that emerges out of their awareness of their interrelated wholeness engenders ethical action, helping them compassionately respond to the needs of the present moment. For these women, nothing is more healing than that. The activities of Zen women demonstrate the depth and breadth of their understanding of teachings they attribute to Dogen. In monastic spheres, they effectively changed the institutional structures to fully support women living Zen. In the domestic realm, they manifest profound insights into bringing Zen home, where life is experienced as an activity of healing. both monastic and lay women demonstrate creativity, wisdom, resilience, and strength in transforming suffering into flourishing, like lotuses blossoming in the mud.